Fisherman's Friend. Y'all know about that? Yeah, it's
good luck selling that too.
It really doesn't taste very good, but all the allergies going on, it definitely helps soothe the throat.
I won't have it right.
Listen.
What a beautiful home.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
You can always tell the guys that don't write songs for a living. And I love the fact that Jim is so lazy that he's made an Easter tree. I wish we were hanging till Monday so I could see the April Fool's damn tree.
July 4th.
I know, yeah. Where do the fireworks go up here? I'm good here, Steve.
Let me see. Get there.
Man, I got all excited, Jim. You were talking about one of Arkansas's natives and a great big hit songwriter, and I thought, well, dang, what difference here again, man? Kept looking for him. Oh, it's you.
Hello.
He's not a Little Rock native. I'll just have to remind
you. Well, that's right. But he's like, what is
Hampton.
Hampton, yeah.
But he's a great guy.
Good writer, too.
He was my very first co-writer when I went to Nashville, by the way.
Wood was?
Wood was, yep.
So you got Wood?
Newton. Oh. Man. It's going to be a long night, isn't
it? Yes, it is. You're going to need more of that fisherman's crap you're sucking on.
Well, it is really great to be here, Jim, and thank you so much for having us. It's great to be back. And this is the first time we've played the Haps concert. We've been at Khalil's all these other times.
Yeah, and played there the last time, and after they heard that show, they turned it into a pool hall. Yeah. So we have a great effect on venues. So, you know, don't throw away your bowling balls when we get done here. Yeah,
so I'd like to kick things off with a song that was actually, I had an idea for a song, and the guy's name was Roger Murray that I was working with. He's one of the guys that came into our company. This was one of the songs I wrote earlier in my career, actually. And I had this idea called Fast Lanes and Gravel Roads. And Roger said, you know, I like that idea, but I think it should be Fast Lanes and Country Roads. So we wrote Fast Lanes and Country Roads, and Barbara Mandrell had a top five hit with this, with Barbara on this, and then later Dierks Bentley recorded it. And his version was really more like the way I envisioned it. It was kind of a rocker. Barbara's was a little more Barbara Mandrellish, however that is. But it was great. I loved it. I mean, it paid a few bills.
Loved going to the mailbox, I know that.
Yeah.
Mine was Fast Lanes and Potholes. It never did.
Anyway, this is Bill Whyte, everybody. So, this is kind of about, I haven't played this song in a while, and last night we opened the show with it because it mentions Arkansas in it, and actually Hot Springs, Arkansas. And I was really excited to get that line in the song and have it stick. You know, because since I'm from Arkansas, I wanted to have Arkansas in a big hit song sometime. So that's what happened. This is Fast Lanes and Country Roads.
Digging for the gold, ready to trade the fast.
I love I don't know if you guys read Sean's bio, but I did. It made me laugh, the part that said Sean has written several albums worth of original material but never released any. And he's made just as much money as I have. That's amazing.
What are you going to do, Mr. Dean?
Well, let's see.
I will say that we were in Fort Smith, Arkansas, a beautiful home last night. Fort Smith, Arkansas, which Steve told me, gave me a little history, was the home of the hanging judge.
That's correct.
And the weekend before, I was in Homestead, Florida, which was the home of the hanging chads. So I'm like on a well-hung weekend here.
Should have known. So I did all my schooling in Little Rock. I grew up there and even went to college in Little Rock. All this time I've been writing songs. I started writing songs when I was 10 years old, I guess, something like that. I learned how to play guitar when I was 9 I was always kind of good at poetry and stuff in school and even had a second grade teacher attach a little note to my report card. Miss Shaddix was her name, out at Jefferson School. And it said, you've been a good student this year. I expect you to be a famous author someday. And I'm like, wow, you know, I thought that was nice, but I had no idea that, because I was a writer, I guess. I was really all showing signs of being a writer at young of age. But anyway, so I got into trying to figure out what I was going to do. And my dad, who's here tonight, by the way, this is Frank Dean right here in the front row. Yeah. And Darlene Giffen is also here. Thank you both for coming. And my sister and Scott Basham, my sister Jandy. And thank you all for coming out, everybody else that came. And anyway, so the point is, I was just trying to figure out what I was going to do with my life, because I always wanted to be in music, but, you know, being in Little, and there was a lot of great music in Little Rock. There was a lot of great, there were studios there, a lot of great songwriters, but there really wasn't any business there, like, that you could actually get your song published or whatever, and possibly get a song cut. It was just really hard. So I never really thought about making a living doing songwriting. I always wanted to, but just one of those things. But so I got into college, and my father said, you know, maybe you should think about going to advertising. Remember that? Maybe you should go into advertising and you could write jingles. And I went, wow, that is a really good idea. I like that idea a lot. So I started getting into the college, getting my classes and stuff. And he sort of nudged me and said, you know, you might want to go the business route. And I thought, okay. Because there was a creative route too. You know, you could take the journalism and all that stuff. Anyway, so I got into, I'm still playing in bands and writing songs and stuff. And I got into like production management and accounting and other, you know, business type courses. And so the one semester that was probably my sophomore year maybe, I came home with a 0.6 on my grade point average. You got any comments?
No, 0.6, that sounds like a songwriter life to me. But, congratulations, you're a PhD.
Yeah. Well, you know, he wasn't mad at me, really. He said, you know, maybe you ought to get out and work a little bit and see what the real world's like, you know, which is a very common sense thing to say. But so I did go back, but he said, you know, you might think about maybe going over to Nashville and getting some established artists to record your songs. Then I went, wow, now that is a great idea. So I got in my little Toyota with $600 in my pocket and my guitar in the back and all the stuff I could cram in that little car and drove to Nashville to be a songwriter. I mean, no cell phone, no computer, no research, nothing. Just going. So I've been there about a year, and the Grand Ole Opry House was having tapings, and they, like, this was been in the early 80s, so the great artists from the late 70s into the early 80s were performing that night. Jim and Johnny were there, Conway and Loretta, Little Jimmy Dickens, Dolly. Yeah, Little Jimmy and Dolly. But that night, the group Alabama came out, and they played a song called Old Flame. And I'd never heard of them before, but I knew that they were, and they weren't really established yet, but I knew they were going to be very, very soon. And I thought, I'm going to get an Alabama cut. Nine years later.
Just like that.
I was an overnight sensation.
So easy.
Yeah. Actually, 2 years before Alabama cut it, David Allan Coe.
See, there you go again. See, two people recording one song.
David Allan Coe also recorded the same song, but neither one of those artists wanted to say the first two lines of the second verse. Now, Randy Owen called us up. He said, boys, we want to record your song, but we don't want to say what y'all said the first two lines of the second verse. Would y'all mind rewriting it for us? And we said, well, let us think about it. Okay, sure. We didn't mind. It didn't make us mad that Randy wanted us to change it. But since this is a songwriter show, I'd like to sing y'all the original first two lines of the original second verse that we wrote. Is that okay?
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Oh, yeah, this is really great. I just love the big heart of my friend here, boy. You folks drove, I don't know how far to be here tonight and paid a cover charge. And, you know, because you did, my great friend Steve Dean is going to do for you the non-hit version of the song. So, just so ginormous of your heart, Mr. Dean. I wonder it took you 9 years to get that cover.
Well, if it's okay with you, Bill,
I'd love to hear the non-hit version. This ought to be good.
Okay. So it went on to become the title track of the Southern Star CD by Alabama.
What's the name of the song?
Oh, Southern Star, Bill. Get rid of my little fisherman friend. I don't know why they call it that, but anyway, so Southern Star by Alabama, number one song for Alabama. Ready?
Yeah.
Two, three. Oh, Southern Star, how I wish you would shine and show.
Show me the way.
get home.
So, the verse that I have played on the radio a gazillion times that they actually recorded, that you rewrote, that these folks I know have heard, yeah, goes like what? What's the first two lines of the second verse?
Well, I know.
On the record.
I know you will like this, these lines better. It says, hey, my DJ friend.
So much better. So much better.
Hey, my DJ friend, won't you play me one more song and let my mind just go.
So yeah, the whole Stephen Stills thing was,
and drift away.
At that time when that song came out, it was like they were big time rock and roll. Of course now
they're more country.
They like the Eagles and the Flying, yeah, Burrito Brothers and people like that would have, yeah, fallen right into mainstream country, I'm sure.
So I'll tell you this though, when Zach Brown records a song,
yeah,
he'll do the original version.
You're going with that, are you?
Yeah, I'm going with that.
You're pressing your luck now, I mean, I'm telling you.
I don't care what they do.
Yeah.
Which one they do, but I'd like them to do the original.
Well, speaking of radio, ooh, I'm just one of the luckiest guys on the planet because I've never had a real job, hardly since I was like 17 years old. You know, I've just lived every day loving what I do, and that was born partly from my dad because two brothers and two sisters and not a lot of money growing up in Missouri, that's where I'm from. Is if we wanted anything, it was the old, well, go get you a job. You know? Even at 16, I found myself, and I was a skinny kid growing up, like 135 pounds, and there I was out in a hayfield, trying to toss hay bales on a wagon and up in a hayloft, and I found out real quick I hated that. And I worked for a grocery store, did that for a while, hated that, worked in a factory, quit that. And then the worst was my dad hired me out to a guy that owned an old one-pump gas station, and the owner was blind, and he fired me. And he couldn't even see how bad a job I was doing. So, you know, I started writing songs when I was like 16, and then when I was 18 years old, I got my first radio job in Missouri, which was in a one-bedroom trailer in Bowling Green, Missouri, in a cow pasture. KPCR Radio, Cow Pasture Country Radio. 1,000 watts of power, boy. And if you left the microphone on, you could hear the cows mooing out of the cow pasture. True story. And they got lucky and had a very blessed, long, major market career doing morning shows all across the country in Cincinnati, Milwaukee, Indianapolis, Nashville. And these days, every now and then, the phone rings and they call me and say, do you want to come in and go to work? And I get to work every now and then at a radio station I grew up listening to as a kid in Missouri and loved. And I get to crack open a microphone and say, you're listening to 650 AM WSM, the home of the By God Grand Ole Opry.
Do you say By God?
No, I don't say that on the air, but yeah. These are our people here, the By God. Then in 2012, so I've always had this blended career playing music and writing songs and doing comedy and being on the radio. And 2012, I was actually writing a song with a young artist who I was excited to write with that day. Young kid, really talented. And on my computer that was open, I got an email message from an old boss that I worked for in Indianapolis. And he had just become the general manager of a cluster of new radio stations in Indianapolis. And he said, hey, Bill, he said, I've lost your phone number and I need to reach you. Shoot me your phone number. And I thought for sure he was going to try to hire me to go back into radio. And I was pretty happy being a starving songwriter at the time. So he found my phone number, the phone rang, and I could remember answering him like a smart aleck and said, Charlie, you are not going to try to make me go back to work in radio, are you? And he said, no, Bill, he said, it's better than that, and I wanted to be the one to tell you that they decide this year they're going to put you in the Country Radio Broadcast Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And I've been out of radio full-time for 3 or 4 years or so, and just never thought that was possible even, so it just knocked me over. And the great part is they have a really wonderful ceremony in Nashville, and one of the guys I worked with at work with now at WSM, Eddie Stubbs, also was inducted the same night at the ceremony, and they let you choose who presents you that night. Eddie chose Marty Stewart, and I chose my friend Linda Davis, who I worked with some out on the road with her husband, Lang Scott. Linda sang Does He Love You with Reba McEntire, and their daughter, Hillary Scott, with Lady Annabella. So that's who presented me that night. It was an amazing night. The best part of it all was Steve came even, which was really cool. Steve and
the
Warren
best
were
part
there.
Of it all.
That was really, yeah, it was really, really cool. I had a lot of friends there that night, but I had two sisters, a brother, and my dad all made it. Only one brother didn't make it, and my family scattered all across the universe. But for my dad to be there that night, who was blind from diabetes, and sat right there at the front table, you know, for a son to be able to have that platform that night and be able to say, thank you, Dad, you know, for all that you did for me is more special than I can ever tell you. And, you know, I just think we live in the greatest country in the world, and I know I'm blessed, and I just believe, Steve and I talk about this all the time, how you get hits and how success happens, and I just think if you work hard enough, long enough, and you don't give up on your talent, that sooner or later, they will run out of people to put into a damn Hall of Fame. So, I had a writing appointment, I had a co-writing appointment one day with myself, and neither of us had a thing to write about. I thought, well, you know, I've never really written about the radio side of my life, which has been over a 30-year career, 35, whatever it is. And so I sat down and wrote this song, and I'll just tell you, it's the most personal song I've ever written, I promise you. And every bit of the song is absolutely true. WGOD Radio.
Man, that's pretty cool. You co-wrote that with yourself.
I did. I mean, I still lost half the publishing somehow. So
I wonder how that happened.
I don't know. The other guy was just insistent. I gave up. Go ahead, sing. Do that song of yours that I love.
Which one?
I don't know which one of the two I like the most. I'd rather have a bottle in front of me than a frontal lobotomy. Are you going to do that? No?
That wasn't on the list. But
no?
No.
I love you, baby, but my aim's getting better. How about that one? No? All right.
About George Strait, man.
Oh,
anybody?
I
heard somebody say George Strait.
Sure. See, yeah, another boring number one song.
This was, when my publisher, when I first got into the publishing business over there back in the early 80s, my publisher said to me, Steve, I need you to write hits.
I'm about to sign a publishing deal and they're insisting that I write crap. So I know I can do that for them, you know? So.
You know why, right? To write hits.
How would I know you got all
hits? That's
why?
What he said to me.
Okay.
Yep. I said, yeah, so we can make some money. He goes, yeah, that's part of it. The other part of it is if you write a hit song for an artist, then in a few years, after their album has been out for a while, in a few years, they're going to put out another greatest hits album. And it'll sell more copies, and that's called mechanical money. And so every time an album sells, we get a few pennies, you know, out of the deal. If it sells millions of albums, it adds up to the thousands of dollars, you know. So it's pretty good. And
so, Sean, you might want to think about releasing an album.
So, Will Nance and I got together and decided early on that we were both George Strait fans. And we wrote this song for George Strait that I'm getting ready to play for you. Now, 99.9% of the time, if you write a song for an artist like George Strait or any other artist, Alabama, anybody, 99.9% of the time, they're not going to cut it. They may not ever hear it, or they just may not cut it. Well, we got the 0.01% that this one happened, that George really liked the song, and he recorded it. So, it was on Carrying Your Love With Me was the first record that this song was on. It was the first track on Carrying Your Love With Me. And that sold 4 million copies. So, you know, got a little check for that.
Yeah, I guess you did.
It's pretty nice. And then about 3 years later, we got notification that he was coming out with the latest, straightest, greatest hits, and it sold another 2 million. And my publisher's like, see what I'm talking about? A few years after that, 50 number ones came out. And so it sold 6 more million.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
Then 60 for 60 came out. He had, at 60 years old, he had his 60th number one. He threw a big birthday party, and anybody that had a number one song on George Strait got invited. So Will and I went together to that party. It was a lot of fun. And the most recent was in November of 17. He came out with Straight Out of the Box Part 2. Now, I don't know how many that sold yet, because it was a Walmart exclusive release, you know, so I haven't gotten any figures on that. But anyway,
well, just this is 50 Shades of Grey soundtrack.
No, it's not. Anyway, this song has been was a whole lot of fun to write, and like I said, we wrote it for George. Now, the bad news was we did the great demo and had a young Texas singer sing it. Sounded just like George Strait. They started pitching it to George. No response there at first, and then Tim McGraw put it on hold, which means, if anybody, everybody probably knows what on hold means. It just means you can't pitch it to anybody else because we're going to cut it. And we were like, dang, man, we wanted George Strait. We didn't want Tim McGraw. But anyway, Tim passed on it, and then about 2 weeks later, George recorded it, and the rest is history. So this is Roundabout Way.
Rule the night. For the most part, I
at home for hours by the phone, wishing she would call. You know something, Bill? Just the other day,
yeah,
I took her ugly face down off the wall. Well, I'm coming on my way, but I still miss her, yeah.
So we're thinking about her. We miss her tonight, you know, being here with Hits and Grins for sure. So we got nobody pretty to break this up.
Betty went to get her palm read at the Ford. She'd tell her, dreaming of fame and wealth and things that he might tell her. She said, I know you gonna tell me how I'm gonna be a big star one day. He gazed down at his crystal ball and said, this is what the big balls say. Everybody's a nobody till you get to be somebody. So don't forget anybody on your way up. You won't always be the big. You'll get older with a bigger body. So be nice to everybody on the way up. Now Betty caught a vision of the silver screen and the next bus to Hollywood. She said, I'll beat all they've ever seen. And she headed out west to make good. Well, she got her a job on the parking lot of a big movie studio yard. And next thing you know, Betty landed a role, and she remembered when she got the part. Everybody's a nobody till you get to be somebody. So don't forget anybody on the way up. You won't always be the big hottie. You'll get older with a bigger body. So be nice to everybody on the way up. Now you don't need a fortune teller or a crystal ball to song. I like that. Sentiments. I'm always trying to... Bill and I do write a lot of songs together. I'm always...
We're too ashamed to play them out.
I'm always looking for something I think is, would be a funny idea, because I like to make people laugh, too. And he does a great job with it. And so one day we had a writing appointment, and I had this funny idea that I thought, and he was like, yeah, you know, he goes, that's good, that's a good idea, we should probably write it sometime. He goes, but there ain't no money in comedy.
And that ain't funny.
So he brings this idea to me that is like really a great idea, and I think this is a really great song, and nobody's cut it yet, but maybe somebody will someday. You never know when that's going to happen. And I couldn't believe it that we wrote this 9 years ago.
Wow. Well, 9 years for Alabama. I like what's coming.
That's what I'm saying.
I like what's coming.
There's hope for it.
I like what's coming.
We used to play this out all the time when we played it.
Yeah.
But then we did those tours out west, and we only had a certain amount of time, so we couldn't really...
And we turned the song into a duo with Victoria.
Not this one.
Oh, not the... Oh, you did something different.
I am.
Oh. Surprising me.
I'm surprising you.
Oh.
We'll do that one later.
Oh, cool. Yeah. I'm glad you're doing this.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. I'll do that one later, Bill.
All right. Yeah, we hardly ever do this. I love this song.
We did it a lot in the beginning. Yep. So, but the tours
haven't done this in like a million years.
Hey, the song's called Never in a Million Years. Two, three.
It's not-
dark ending on that depressed the hell out of everybody. It's a nice little lovey-dovey song and then a train wreck at the end. So some of you, you know, we get to see when we make these trips, so Steve and I made a concerted effort to try to, you can hear that we're trying to play some songs that you've never heard before and some new songs, and I'm going to do another one of those right now. And just to show you how small a world it is when you travel, man, I write a lot with a young, real-deal cowboy, great country singer named Paul Bogart, and Steve and I have written together with Paul, too. He's a guard that sent him to Nashville, that kind of deal. Rodeoed, and his dad rodeoed, and all that stuff. So he sings George Strait, real stuff, country music, and some cowboy music, which I really love. And I could never be a cowboy if my life depended on it, but I love the romance of cowboy music, and I've always loved the Sons of the Pioneers and those Western singers, Rex Allen and people like that, and the culture. So I love sitting in the room writing with Paul Bogart. That's his name. And Sean told me that he books a casino over in Oklahoma and books Paul over there to play all the time. So
He played Sunday.
He's great. He's just really, really great. We wrote a song called All That Cowboy Jazz, which is like a Western swing song that Paul's got on his current album. They did a video on it. You can look it up. It's really great. And they shot the video over in Ooliga, Oklahoma. I just remembered where that was, at a little honky-tonk bar called the Iron Horse. And those people got, the whole town showed up for this video shoot. And the bar owner loved it so much that I've got to go sometime because they put the logo of our song on their dance floor. It's there right now, All That Cowboy Jazz, which is really cool. So I love writing with Paul. And Paul just had his second little buckaroo. The second little buckaroo was born on the I-40 East, flying down the highway in the middle of the night trying to get to St. Thomas Hospital, and they didn't get there in time. And in Paul's word, at exit 199, we just wrote this whole song, at exit 199, he heard sploosh. And the baby was born on the floorboard before they could get to St. Thomas. So he loves his little buckaroos, and I had a writing appointment with him one day at Sony Records, and he was just telling me how he and his wife, he'd gotten off a road trip actually out from Wyoming, and he said, I've started this little idea, and he says, I want to play that. He had this first verse that you're going to hear. And he said, so he sang me the first verse, and I said, man, I love that. I want to help write that, and got a chorus for him really quick, because he and his wife sing to their little boys at night. They sing them a lullaby, but he said, we sing these god-awful songs because we don't have any lullabies. So he wanted to write a little lullaby for his boy. And his album, which is called Leather, is just spectacular. It was done. They finished the album completely. And we wrote the song, and he called his producer and said, I got to play this song. And they stopped the presses, and they went and took a song off and actually put this on the album. So this is Paul's, it's a little Western song. I love this. Buckshot and pour him some green and curry the burrs from his head. Throw on your best saddle and tighten it up and crawl in the middle and ride down through. like buckshot, the way you'll both ride. But when you have your own, you'll still have our song to sing to him every night. So dream innocent dreams as long as you can. Go on and close your little blue eyes. Then tomorrow night, sing it again. This buckaroo. He's so good.
Okay, well, hang on, Pat.
Actually, Paul helped me write I Ain't Drinking Alone, the Dog's Home. So we're actually hoping he's going to release that as a Christmas single this coming Christmas.